Thank you very much for inviting me for this conference. I'm really happy to be with you even via cyberspace. And I thought that I could take some time once addressing recent issues and controversies related to gender and sexuality, which have been heavily discussed in Europe, and they relate to Hungary. However, the same issues we used to have in Poland and probably soon we will have also similar as in Hungary political debate concerning LGBT rights and stuff. And I will try to put this thing in a broader mechanisms of using this kind of symbolism and what is the relevance of this. And starting from short introduction, I will focus on Polish case, of course. So students of Polish politics usually note that post-1989 Poland is characterized by the public debates of assessing its actual or imaginary state of maturity according to self-reported European values, which commonly represent ideals of modernization and good citizenship. Otherwise, it is a typical game for European semi-peripheral countries. And two discursive currents dominate struggle over application of Europeanness or European values to the Polish post-1989 political context. A conservative faction advocating regional protectionism over its resources, a different type of resources, political, economic, cultural, and liberal faction advocating European values. And I argue that lacking a stable, positive context, the content, the category European values is an empty signifier, as it is stated in Ernesto Laclau's terms. Political rivals seek to transform the particularistic signifiers into dimension of universal meaning, which resonates with the wider sensitives of the public and leads to the exercise of power relations. And this is the very sense of using this empty signifiers, in this case, European values. And I will indicate soon in my presentation how signifiers related to gender and sexuality have gradually rose to prominence as a moral indicator of good and bad citizenship in Poland. And LGBT rights have fueled political campaigns strategically deployed in political struggles over notions of civic responsibility, citizenship, and articulations of Europeanness. And who is taking part in this political struggle over European values in Poland? And these are two rivaling mainly factions of the Polish intelligentsia, who have struggled over last decades for hegemony over citizenship models, most notably waging moral disputes about good and bad citizen ideals. And in general, in Central and Eastern European societies, I have to explain it, where the bourgeois has been weakly established and where a high degree of foreign ownership of financial assets has dominated, a post-gentry intelligentsia stratum, the elite of cultural capital, has historically set the parameters of civic responsibility. Political struggles in Poland have thus had less to do with typical for Western type of European societies, to do with class conflicts over the distribution of material capital, and more to do with tensions between different factions of the cultural capital-oriented intelligentsia. Moreover, the Polish intelligentsia strata evolved historically out of the waning landed nobility and their notions of civic responsibility. Even though the intelligentsia's ideological imaginary was mostly shaped by the late 19th century ideas of democratic politics, their civic frameworks were substantially influenced by the feudal division between good, that is noble, and bad, usually landless peasant citizens, lords versus boor. And during the 20th century, the notion of the good citizen was redefined to signify the paternalistic figure who takes responsibility for the civic sphere and thereby serves the nation, while boor denotes the non-responsible citizen or non-citizen who did not take responsibility for the republic. This persistent binary has made the polycitizenship model strongly hierarchical and exclusive. And polycitizenship politics, either in the interwar period or during the post-communist era, were strongly influenced by moralization, encouraging the public to participate in the civic sphere and comply with the ideals of the republic, embodied by the figure of the intelligentsia member, educated, politically responsible individual. This culturalist approach has served to establish a hegemonic code of legitimate moral citizenship and excluded subjects who supposedly fail to comply with the normative ideals, those who do not fulfill the culturally defined boundaries of the nation. Now, in the post-communist era, boundary setting between lordish and boorish citizens have largely been characterized by antagonistic tension between liberal and conservative factions of the intelligentsia. Self-proclaimed real Europeans among the post-1989 liberal intelligentsia expressed a moral superiority attitude towards not real Europeans on the basis of possessing entrepreneurial qualities required for a successful European integration. Informed by the Lord Boor binary, liberal intelligentsia members sought to combat forces set to impede European integration, casting various categories of citizens as out of joint with the modern world. And this was particularly the case in political campaigns against the Homo Sovieticus figure, coined in the early 1990s public discourse. The Homo Sovieticus figure was allegedly failing to adapt because of its lack of self-management skills. A corresponding opposition is the one between educated and the poorly educated, the latter presumably incapable of taking advantages of socioeconomic transformations. Related plural oppositions, of course, included open-minded versus close-minded, secular versus religious, and rational versus superstitious. Now, it is important to note in this context that over the last three decades, there has been strong asymmetry between pro-European elite discourses, associated, of course, with the liberal intelligentsia, and Eurosceptical ones, associated with the nationalism fractions, in their capacity to shape formal and informal hierarchies of citizenship in Poland. Political hegemony has belonged to the elite factions, which have presented their ideological stand in line with the self-reported dominant neoliberal compromise reigning in core European countries. In other words, the political elite have enjoyed the hegemonic position of being able to articulate an undisputable universal model of good citizenship that ought to be implemented in the semi-peripheral CEE countries, including Poland. This asymmetry did not change significantly until the 2008 economic crisis, when the neoliberal compromise started to unravel globally, followed by the so-called European migration crisis of 2015. These two moments of articulated crisis paved the way for the right-wing Law and Justice Party, whose victory in the parliamentary elections in 2015 meant that the cultural hierarchy between Euro-enthusiastic and nationalist or protectionist discourses gradually crumbled. Clearly, this displacement considerably weakened the neoliberal ideological agency in its capacity to interpolate Polish political subjectivities. But it also gave rise to more moralized and polarized debate revolving around, among other issues, gender and sexuality. And now I'm getting closer to an end. We'll try to explain within the proposed framework of the semi-peripheral Poland how these gender and sexuality issues were revolving in power discourses. After Poland's EU accession, right-wing nationalist forces increasingly portrayed Europe as morally corrupt, juxtaposing European perversion with healthy Polish traditionalism capable of resisting the pressure to conform to EU-imposed standards. For instance, homosexuality was portrayed as not only alien to Polish traditions. To combat the alleged menace posed by foreign enemies, it is imperative, as this dominant claim goes on, was to reassert authentic national and European traditions of which political and religious leaders claim exclusive ownership. In contrast, many in liberal camp viewed the 2015 peace or law and justice parliamentary victory as a triumph of the political pariah, purportedly is opening up for an inflow of plebeian aspirations in public space and giving rise to unacceptable political articulations in terms of nationalism, homophobia, anti-democracy, and so on. Social media users and newspaper columnists in the Polish liberal camp have resorted to classism and ageism when fingering majority constituencies as rural, uneducated, elderly, peasants from underdeveloped regions. These anti-populist statements express and provoke feelings that clearly tap into symbolic registers rooted in the Lord Boer distance we just mentioned. We are civilized and morally responsible citizens, whereas they are unruly and irresponsible. As with nationalist populist discourse, liberal anti-populist articulations of threatened identities draw on established sedimented practices predicted on mythical ideas of the pure but lost fullness, the moral integrity of society. Moreover, this attempt to articulate a cultural and moral crisis within a civilizational frame are enmeshed in the East-West dynamic of self-colonization. It could be argued that efforts home and abroad to shame Poland or the CEE region more broadly, including Hungary in this case, as backward, while construing the West as essentially progressive, do not merely belie the more complex reality, but inevitably reinsert the colonial imperial moral and cultural superiority of core Europe. Therefore, LGBT rights-related signifiers used in shaming practices to exert political leverage are readily available in anti-populist liberal politics insofar as they symbolize civilizational Europeans. And now a few words for conclusion. Given the prevalent role of cultural capital in Polish public life, it does not come as a surprise that right-wing nationalists, populists, take criticism of their policies as attacks on sacred resources, whereas the Euro-enthusiastic camp see EU integration as a modernization process, including sexual modernization in this case, a movement away from Eastern superstitions towards Western rationality. For self-proclaimed nationalists, moral panics pertaining to gender and sexuality serve to justify moral responsibilization techniques in the name of defense, while also giving a mythic explanation for why desired family values are deprived of their social fullness. Nationalist campaigners seek to expose European corruptness that must be blocked by good citizens representing and yearning for the genuine, non-corrupt European universal civilization. Their liberal counterparts, on the other hand, make claims to European values through a civilizational discourse of modernization. On both sides of the political divide, whether phrased in terms of sexual modernity or Christian civilization, we see a self-orientalizing positioning towards the empty signifier of European values. Thank you very much for your attention.